And hello again, everyone, and welcome back to The Longest Journey. Now, if you remember in our last time, April Ryan, our heroine, was apparently having what she thinks is a dream where she saw a dragon who called her the mother of the future, and then a dark chaos cloud attacked, and she fell from a cliff and woke up. And so we are going to pick up with chapter one where that happened. So let's get back to The Longest Journey.
What a nightmare. I'm completely exhausted. I must have been tossing and turning all night. So hot in here, too. No wonder I keep having these weird dreams. I've basically been simmering in my own sweat every night this past week. Doesn't look like it's gonna cool down anytime soon, either. It's another sunny day in Newport. Well, it's a good thing the studio's got proper air conditioning. I promised myself I was gonna spend most of the day working, and I don't intend to break that promise. Not this time.
Alright, and at this point we're back in control of things. Now, this is a typical point-and-click adventure, especially from the 90s, and we get a lot of our stuff done by interacting with the environment. Now, and this is how most of the story takes place. For example, we can click on things like this.
It's a bunch of drawings I drew when I was a kid. I don't even know why I brought them here. They mean absolutely nothing to me.
And this is how we find out about April and her friends.
I could only carry one suitcase with me when I left home. There was so much I would have loved to bring, but c'est la vie. At least it was a clean break with my past. I guess when all my hard work starts paying off, I'll get a house and fill it with all kinds of new junk. The past, who needs it? Alright, so my wardrobe's sort of chic deficient, but I can't afford to be cutting edge. Useful, practical, and cheap is my shopping mantra.
And anyway, there's more we can do in there, but we don't need to do it right now. The main things we need to pick up for right now are we need to look at this picture over here.
It's a picture of me and my friends.
And one of the odd things here is that if you look at something in the environment, you sometimes can't get all the information on it. You have to put it in your inventory and then look at it again.
It's a picture of Charlie, Emma, and me in Florence Park. Marcus took it about a month ago before it got real hot.
And so Charlie, Emma, and Marcus are her friends that we will be interacting with a lot. This is her cash card. Apparently in the future, we do everything by debit card. The game is set in 2209, so it's about two centuries from now.
My on-again, off-again diary. We've had a turbulent relationship, her and I.
And again. The main thing we need here is this piece of paper.
There's a loose sheet of paper in here. Hey, it's my timesheet from the cafe! I completely forgot I put it in here. Good thing I found it, because I'm broke.
And yes, even though this is two centuries in the future, we're still using books.
I'm part of the should-be-reading-more-but-life's-too-short generation. We embrace our illiteracy. The last book I read was How to Seduce the Man of Your Dreams. Now, if I can just find a man to dream about, I'll be all set.
And yeah, there's some, you know, other stuff
we can do. The wardrobe is actually made of real wood, and not that synthetic crap that makes me sneeze and itch all over.
And again, like I said, there's more stuff we can do in here, but we don't need to do it right now.
I'd better head over to the studio to do some work. Only 2 weeks until the big show opens, and my contribution is in serious need of attention. Might be a good idea to get dressed first, though.
Hey, babe. Babe, you're looking real sexy today.
Zach, listen, I've got to run, and...
What's going on, April? How you been?
Pretty good, and you?
Fantastic. Listen, April, how about you and me getting together sometime soon? Like, tonight. The pavilion is really cooking this week. We could pop some raptures, do a little close dancing. How about it?
Yeah, Zach's a bit of a jerk here, isn't he?
No, that's not gonna work, Zach.
What? You got something against me, babe? Do I offend you in some way?
Oh, no. I just don't think it's a good idea for us to be together like that.
Hey, whatever. You'll come crawling back when you realize your mistake, babe. I'm out of here.
What an asshole.
Well, I'm glad we agree with each other, April. There's a few things of interest here. For example, we have this plant here in the foreground.
Organic plastic. It grows, and it converts carbon dioxide into oxygen, just like real plants, but it doesn't need nourishment of any kind. Convenient, but disturbing.
Yeah, it's interesting. In the way they did their world building, for example, we have this thing called the free access terminal back here.
It's a fact, as in F-A-C-T, free access terminal.
So, we're in the future. We obviously knew we would be using something like the internet in the future. That's what the fact is. You can interact with it, but you really can't do anything with it. We have artificial plastic plants, but we're still using books and not e-readers. No one in the game seems to have a computer in their room or in their desk, even though these are all college students. No one carries a cell phone around, even though cell phones already existed in 1999 when the game took place, or when the game was written. So this isn't a slam against the game, this is just how hard it can be sometimes to do science fiction world building. Because, well, you're trying to extrapolate from the day, and if, you know, reality seldom goes in the direction we think it's going to. Let's look at this bulletin board up here for a while.
Be considerate. Keep the volume down after 11 p.m. Fiona. Common room, duty roster, July 27th. April and Emma. Oh, joy, manual labor, my favorite. San Francisco. I'd love to go there someday. Someday soon, hopefully. Pizza and movie night, Monday, July 31st. BYOS. BYO what? Soap?
Okay.
Annual summer blowout at the Fringe Cafe, Friday, August 4th, 8 p.m. Free food, live performances by Royne Dale, Harlequin Masquerade, The Go-Getters. Tickets available at the bar, $10 only, spread the word.
Okay, we could keep this. The only thing we really need to worry about here is this note here.
I can't tell what that note's saying as long as it's up there. Fiona's handwriting is not particularly legible.
This is kind of a hint if you haven't realized that you have to pick things up to look at them yet.
Found. A gold ring under the common room sofa. If it's yours, let me know. But no false claims, please. Fiona. I did lose a gold ring a few weeks ago. I hope this is the one. I'll have to ask Fiona about it.
All right.
The omnipresent screen. I don't pretend to know how it works, but all the data apparently passes through tiny little black holes in the fabric of our dimension. You know, that really freaks me out when I think about it.
And talking about science fiction world building, I'm not sure if that's really how their TV works, or if this is just showing that April has no idea how technology works. And being good adventure players, let's pick up the matchbook. Here we go. Alright, now at this point we can go over here and talk to Fiona. This is Fiona right here. Now, one of the things about this game is that this game has a lot of very deep conversation trees. I've actually timed it. If you go through Fiona's entire conversation tree, you will spend over 10 minutes talking to Fiona. And, you know, I'm not sure that's the most exciting thing for us to do right here. So let me try to summarize what the main conversation with Fiona would be. She's going to mention that there are some plumbing problems, and the basement is flooded here in this building right now, and her partner, Mickey, is downstairs trying to clean it up right now. Mickey is an older woman that Fiona's in love with. They're going to talk about April's friends, including Emma, who is her best friend. Emma, they say, has very bad taste in men, and they're going to let it go at that. They're going to talk about Zach, who everyone agrees he's a bit of an ass, but he's not a bastard. This seems to be an important distinction to them. And they're going to talk about Charlie, who is April, a very good friend of April's. Fiona says Charlie could be more than a friend if you want him to be, and April doesn't seem to know what they're talking about. They also talk about Fiona and Mickey. Fiona is from England. Mickey was the older woman who she fell in love with and came back to the Americas with her. And they founded this place, which is called the Border House. It is a boarding house for students and artists. And they are in the town of Newport, in a district of Newport called Venice. Venice is the young, hip, happening art district where the Venice Academy of the Visual Arts, which is where all of these people are going to school at, exist. So they say that Newport is one of the great cities of the age, and the Border House sits on the border between Venice and Newport, and between the arts and the sciences. That pretty much gives us the quick rundown of what we would have heard from Fiona. There is one thing we have to talk to Fiona about, and that is this note. So we're going to go ahead and talk about that now.
I saw this note on the corkboard. I think the ring might belong to me.
I'm sorry I have to ask, but could you describe the ring?
Sure thing. It says Sweet 16. My dad gave it to me. I think it was the only birthday of mine he remembered, or at least acknowledged.
Yes, that's the one. I found it under the sofa when I was vacuuming. Here you are, darling.
Thanks. It's not worth much, but it's got a certain sentimental value for me.
It's a very pretty ring.
Yeah, it is. My dad never gave me anything pretty before or since. He must have won a poker game or something that day. You know what's strange? I don't hate him. He's a bastard and he treated me like crap almost every single day of my life. But I don't hate him. I feel sorry for him.
Why?
Because he doesn't know how to love. He can't love anybody or anything. And because he'll be miserable every second of every minute of every day until the day he dies. God, I'm glad that life is behind me. I hope I never have to see him again. No, that doesn't sound right. I've made a choice not to see him again. Ever.
Okay. Like I said, there's some more we could do here. I may actually post that conversation separately. But anyway, let's head on out and start exploring Newport and Venice.
I love this mural. Even though the motif is a little trite. I mean, fairy tale forests and magical dragons? Still, it's pretty. I wonder what happened to the artist. Probably making a bundle from cheesy fantasy calendars and book covers.
Yeah, she doesn't connect this dragon to her dream, obviously. There's a machine over here that we can interact with. Again, we don't need to do that right now. I'm going to go ahead and wait till later to work on it. Let's head on down this way, where we're going to meet another one of our main characters in the game. We're going to meet Señor Cortez.
Oye, señorita.
Yes?
How are you this morning, señorita bonita?
Hot.
I see. The summers in Newport are never pleasant. And it will get worse before it gets better. They say there's another heat wave headed our way.
Yeah, so I heard. So, you gonna be all right? You don't look dressed for the weather.
Si Dios quiere. Sunshine and pretty señoritas give an old man like me the blues. I like my days cold and rainy. In fact, I think I prefer the world to be in black and white.
Like an old movie?
Like all good movies. But tell me, Señorita Ryan, how would you describe your perfect day?
Hot and sunny like this one.
Well then, you should be happy to be alive today, yes? It is a perfect day. But you are not happy, are you? You are troubled by nightmares.
What?
You are afraid of them. You even fear your dreams may be real.
Who told you about my nightmares?
no one. I can tell from looking into your eyes. I see the ghosts that haunt you.
I don't know who you've been talking to, but from now on, stay the hell away from me in my personal life.
No puedo, señorita Ryan. You have a destiny.
Destiny? I don't care what you think. Just leave me alone.
If you don't face them, I'm afraid your nightmares will continue. Soon they will appear to you even when you're awake.
You need some serious help, you know that?
We all do, April. That's the reason we are here, you and me.
That's it. I don't have to listen to this.
Perdóname. I've upset you. We didn't think you'd react this way. I hope we can talk again soon.
I don't think so, no.
Please, think about it. And señorita, cuidado. Be careful.
So, yeah, that's a little creepy that Cortez seems to know about this stuff. I'll also point out that Cortez says, we didn't expect you to react this way. So, apparently he's not working on the phone. Yes, it's the future! Okay. And is it just me, or is this guy almost skipping down the road? He is definitely the happiest guy in the game, I think. I mean, look at the way he's walking. Alright, there's several places we can go here. We can go over to the subway, we can go over to the park, and we can go over to the cafe. Now, we need to go over to the park, because we need to, I just can't believe how happy they've managed to make this guy. Just keep skipping along. We need to go over to the park, and because we have to get to the academy. Now, one of the things about this game is if I double-click on an exit, April will run to get there. And since this is a fairly long game, we're going to let her run over there. And obviously this area is called Venice because of the canals. But I'm not sure that's water in the canal, but whatever. Here's the big park, and April has things to say about it.
Nothing adds more to the tranquility of a city park than a huge rusty iron bridge. I can't even begin to guess what that's supposed to be.
Okay, it looks like it's a trash can, and I think it's a little odd that she doesn't know what a trash can is, but...
Very... cubist. And not my style at all. This guy's out here all day long, all year. He never stops painting. Ever. And I doubt he's ever finished even one painting.
Alright, that's enough of this. Let's head on to the academy. Just a tiny bit of world building there.
Bishop and Anne-Marie. He's a photography student. She's in my life study class. Nice couple.
Okay, this is the Venice Academy of Performing Art, or Visual Arts.
That's Mary Sam, Vava's founding mother and pro-Venice activist back before the riots. She was assassinated by a corporate hired gun right after the school opened, some 90 years ago.
So, yeah, obviously they've had some problems here in the past.
It's the official Vava notice board. Only registered students are allowed to put notices up here.
And there's another trash can right there, but she doesn't seem to be confused by it, so I don't know.
Nice. Very Van Gogh-ish, with just a hint of Munch.
And notice the whoever the artist here is doesn't even seem to react to that.
Olav's on a roll. Again. Does that guy ever run out of inspiration or energy? Must be the cold Norwegian winters. Nothing else to do but paint.
Meanwhile, there's a glove here. Best adventure game fashion will pick it
up. Why would somebody toss out a perfectly good work glove with just one big hole in it? What a terrible, terrible waste.
Now, wouldn't the one big hole and perfectly good kind of contradict each other? Do we have a hologram? Because it is the future.
Emma's really good with the holosculptor, and her imagination is so vivid. Good thing we're best friends, or I might be jealous.
You're also an artist, not a holosculptor, so...
Some books on color, composition, and... duck hunting?
And again, actual books, no e-books here.
The tools of my trade. The best thing about working up here is that nobody borrows my stuff.
Well, we came up here to paint. We could look at some more of this stuff around here.
Those are some of my most recent sketches. Unfortunately, they serve only as a barren testament to my lack of inspiration.
Yeah, we could get a lot more little details like that, but let's get on with what we're up here for. You're an artist? There we go. You're an artist, so let's do some art. I notice they cleverly never show us what any of these canvases look like. Notice they're always faced away from us. See, we barely even got a glimpse of the front of that thing.
Hiya.
Emma? Hi! I didn't expect to see you here today.
Me neither. Are you busy?
Nah. Well, I am. But I was about to wrap up for today anyway. Why? What's going on?
I have an important message for you.
I really hope it's not from my mom.
Not even close, girlfriend. It's from Cortez.
Cortez?
Yep. He said to tell you to meet him where children visualize their dreams.
Visualize dreams? What's that supposed to mean?
Me? I was hoping you would know.
Did he talk to you about nightmares?
No. Why?
I don't know. It's just... my dreams are really starting to bother me.
There you go again with dreams. You're obsessing, April. They're just dreams. Sometimes a banana is just a banana.
And a dragon is just a dragon.
What's dragons got to do with it? Oh, don't tell me you had a dream about dragons.
A dragon. A talking dragon.
I'm gonna regret this, but what happened in your dream?
Well, there was a dragon.
I think we established that already. You had a dream about a dragon.
Not just any dragon, though. A talking dragon.
Yep, we've been through that. Talking dragon covered. What did it say?
She. It was a she, a female dragon.
What, you could tell from the skirt, high heels, and lipstick?
Don't mock me, Emma. She said something to me. Something about being the mother of the future.
She probably said time to get up and go to school, April.
If you don't want to take my dreams seriously, I'll just stop telling you about them.
Is that a promise?
Like you're in any position to make fun of my dreams? Have you looked at your sculptures lately?
Oh, that's low. I'd punch you out if I wasn't so hungry. You want to go get some lunch at the Fringe?
I'll drop by after I clean up around here.
I'll be there for a while, so bye.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting that before, April was kind of weirded out by Cortez and didn't want to have anything else to do with him. And now she's suddenly interested in what he had to say. So, what changed?
Who's there?
Hey, that was not a dream, I think.
Okay, the question here is, that's a holographic projector, obviously, a holosculptor, or whatever she called it. Could it not necessarily do that normally? I mean, is all the holosculptor does is make these kind of wireframe-looking things? So, I don't know why she thought that was such a bizarre event. Obviously, it doesn't do that normally. And I kind of wonder, at this point April starts getting a little obsessed by Cortez. And I'm wondering if, hey, the guy who never quit painting has quit painting. I kind of wonder if the fact that Cortez had said that her dream might start appearing while she's awake.
Nice hair color.
I wonder if the fact that she saw the dragon come to life, she had a waking dream, is why she suddenly starts taking Cortez seriously at this point. Because she starts getting a little obsessed with Cortez. Anyway, we're going to go back to the, let's just scoot through here. There's other people we can look at. We'll head over to the Fringe Cafe, where we'll meet Charlie, who is another one of her friends, and talk to her boss and Emma some more. And they're skateboarders. They're not hoverboards.
Man, those guys are in trouble. Don't they know that skateboarding is strictly prohibited in Newport?
Yeah, and whoa, he's got an automatic weapon on the skateboarder. And what's this guy doing? This guy's just standing here staring at an empty bench, but okay. Yeah, skateboards, 23rd century. Why not? And we got some, what is pop culture like 2 centuries from now?
Can you say Death Star? Let's blow this thing and go home. Look at the size of that thing.
Use the Force, Luke.
So apparently in 2209, they still remember Star Wars.
I don't think I've ever seen anybody pass through that door. Isn't that peculiar? And if I was Nancy Drew, I might actually care.
Now, I'm not sure if that's a reference to the fact that, again, Nancy Drew is still being read 2 centuries from now, or the fact that there is a very long-running series of adventure games based on Nancy Drew, and I'm wondering if that was a comment on the competition, so to speak. Don't know. We'll find out. Now, here we are inside the Fringe Cafe. This is Charlie, her friend.
Hi, Charlie.
April, nice to see you, girl. You know, I came to wake you this morning, but you had already left. Early bird catches the worm.
No, early bird finishes the damn painting on time. Have you seen Cortez around?
As a matter of fact, I have. And he was asking for you.
He asked about me?
Yeah, where you were. He had a message for you. I told him to give it to Emma, that she would be more likely to bump into you.
I got it, but I have no idea what it means.
Cortez can be a little strange.
Do you have any idea where kids would be able to, visualize their dreams?
Maybe in therapy.
I don't think that's it, Charlie.
Then I don't know.
Anyway, I'm not going to go through this whole tree again. This is another long conversation.
Anytime, April.
It's not letting me get off the end here, so hang on. There we go.
I have to get going, Charlie.
Take care, all right? Remember, you're supposed to get paid today. Stan's not going to remember unless you bug him about it.
Again, if we talk to Charlie, it's another 5 to 10 minutes from the conversations. Charlie will basically tell you that he's from St. Vincent. He is also a student at BAVA. He is a dance student. He does not get along well with his father, but he's going to be going home soon to meet his family. He talks a long time about his father and his sisters and that sort of thing. And he also mentions how Emma and especially April are the best friends he's ever had. So, again, it's long conversations, so we're gonna...
I'm sure Stan won't notice if I dig gently into his supply. He's got crates of these in the back.
I'm just gonna get a piece of candy over here, because the can, that might be useful. Now this is Stan, who we work for, and I think... Is that supposed to be a circuit board on his shirt, or is that a, Chinese characters? What are they trying to go for?
What
there?
You doing here?
I...
You ain't working this afternoon, are you? I don't want my employees work 24 hours a day. Go, get sleep.
But I'm just...
Damn woman, do I have to babysit you?
It's nice to see you too, Stanley. No, I'm not working today. I just came by to...
Oh, don't ever say those two words when I'm around. I don't think my ulcer can take it.
You? And nice?
That's funny. No, working and not. Don't use those two words in the same sentence. Damn, I get creeps even when I say them.
I thought you'd be ecstatic to have people work 24-hour shifts.
Oh, don't get me wrong, sweetheart. There's nothing I'd want more, but you see, for some weird reason, it is illegal to make people work that long.
What a downer.
Yeah, I'd make you guys work triple shifts if I could.
Nah, I don't think you would. I think you're a real angel at heart, Stanley. You're just afraid people will find out.
Yeah, I'm a real goddamn sweetheart. Go on, take advantage of my kindness while I'm still out of my head.
I'd like to get paid.
Damn, woman, don't you know I got a migraine already? Paid? God damn it. Why'd they have to make that word sound so obscene? Listen, why don't you leave old Stan alone, huh? They make me feel a whole hell of a lot better. Choo, choo, be good, little girl, hmm?
I'd still like to get paid, though.
Mighty Manow woman. You really know how to rub it in. God damn it. Yeah, all right. You got your timesheet?
Yes?
Yes? Yes? Let's see it. God damn, you think I'm gonna take your word for a woman?
Yeah, this is why we had to get the timesheet out of the diary earlier. There we go.
Here you are, my timesheet.
Don't say that word too loud, sweetheart. You're killing me. Let's see. What is this? Huh? No, 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 no. Did I sign this? What am I thinking?
So?
At least... it doesn't look like it's been forged. Thanks.
Thanks? Where's my money?
Oh, you ain't getting it now. Next week, honey. I write down this amount in my ledger. Don't you worry your head from it.
Forget that. I quit.
You're quitting? You can't quit. You work for me. Nobody quits this job, honey.
I can quit, and I'm quitting. I quit.
Damn, woman. You know how hard it is to find people to take a crappy job like this one? I need you.
Just as much as you need the money?
All right. Jesus, I give you your damn money. What was it? $50?
$375, Stanley. Cash.
Oh, sure. Cash. 300? Are you sure? I pay you guys way too much. All right, give me your CC.
I'm trying to decide if Stanley's supposed to have a Russian accent. I can't quite place that one. But, okay.
Thank you, Stanley.
Fine, sure, whatever. Hey, just I mean it. You free tonight? Wanna pull a shift? Sandra, she out sick and I need a replacement pronto. How about it?
Well, we need to avoid Zack, so...
Yeah, I need the money.
Great, hon. I'll see you here later. Don't forget.
And actually, it doesn't matter whether you show up here or not. The plot will continue. That's kind of a meaningless plot division.
It's a jukebox, according to Stan. It's an original. Almost 200 years old. I don't know. That looks like a replica to me. A good replica, but still. Roma Gallery presents Growing Pains, an exhibition by and for kids and teenagers. Could this be what Cortez was talking about? Where kids visualize their dreams? I think this may be it. Where's the Roma Gallery located?
Well, fortunately, there's a ticket here.
I never say no to a complimentary ticket. It's the address. The gallery's located near the Watertown Bridge. It's all the way over in West Venice, if I remember correctly. I'm gonna have to catch the Metro Line subway to get there.
I'll also feel obligated to point out that that phone number, I guess that's a correctly formatted North American phone number, except for that last two digits on it. But, you know, two centuries in the future from now, who knows? There we go. If I had talked to, when you talked to Charlie earlier, he'll tell you that Cortez was really interested in that poster.
When she's not working, or out on a date, Emma's always hanging out here. Just like me, really. Just like all of us.
Now, we need to get one more thing from here. We need to get some bread from this bread basket. And then we can talk to Emma for a while.
Settle this one for us, April. When did Roine Dale release Sidetracked?
04, right after the Morning Star exile, those sons of bitches.
With blood on their boots, yeah. Told you so, Marcus.
You said 03.
I was closer than you. 07, and you call yourself a fan.
I don't.
Did you speak with Zack today?
Why?
He was upset. Called you a stuck-up bitch.
He what? You gotta be kidding me. I wasn't even that rude to him.
You'd think so. So that even if you came crawling to his door, he wouldn't give you the time of day. Said you called him an asshole.
Oh, God. I really don't know when to shut my mouth, do I?
Who cares? It's Zack. He hates you, so what? No great loss.
That's true.
So what else is going on? What are you doing this afternoon?
Actually, I came by to see if I could find Cortez.
What's with you and this guy? You'd rather spend time with him than us?
I have to find out what the message means.
Don't look at me. I don't know anything except what I already told you. Ask Charlie. He spoke with Cortez earlier.
Mind if I ask you some questions, Emma?
Like I don't tell you everything that's going on anyway? Of course you can ask me questions. Like, duh.
What's your, take on Cortez?
My take on Cortez? What's that, like a diplomatic way of saying what the F is this guy's glitch?
Sure. Let's go with that one.
You know, I think Cortez is a barrel of laughs. In a good way. Everybody thinks they got him all figured out, you know? Like he's the resident weirdo. But I know that just ain't true. I've talked with Cortez, and the guy is brilliant. He's weird, yeah, and he's up in the clouds, and I think he believes in aliens, which is cool, but girl, he's smart. I mean, I'm not talking professor smart here. I'm talking real life, seen it all, been there, done that, smart. Useful smart. Experienced smart. And, ooh, I gotta tell you, the guy's cultured. Ask him about anything. Art, music, movies, books. He's current on most topics, which scares me, because it seems he's always just, I don't know, hanging around doing nothing. He rarely goes anywhere. And it's like he's waiting for something. Or someone.
Yeah, maybe Jerry Garcia.
You're bad. No, I don't think he's a doper. I mean, listen to the guy. What he says may sound a little out there, but the way he says it... No, he's not on Amethyst, that's for sure. And one more thing, he is cute.
He's what?
Cute!
Emma, he's like 60!
Did you ever see his eyes? Those are not the eyes of an old man. And so what if he's 60? He's better looking than most of the guys I date, and so much nicer.
Then I think you've been swimming in the shallow end of the gene pool for too long, Emma. I mean, come on, a 60-year-old screwball with a ponytail and an exotic accent? Hello? Well, we'll see.
Anyway.
Thanks, Emma.
Thanks for what? For talking to you? Girlfriend, what the hell is the matter with you? Snap out of it!
I gotta run.
See you around, stranger.
Yeah, there was more we could talk to her about things, but it's all minor stuff. One of the other points that I didn't mention when I summarized Charlie's conversation earlier is that Cortez is apparently really big on classic films and books. So, you know, the classic films from the late 20th and early 21st century, 200 years ago. Alright, let's go see if we can find Cortez at this at this gallery. Yeah, the skate punks are still here. Subway's over here. Why is this guy just sitting here staring at an empty bench? I don't get it. Alright, here's the subway station. You can get to the park over here, so there's two different ways you can get to the subway. Almost like French subways. Alright, what we have to do in here is we have to use this little machine over here. It's a genetic scanner.
It's a gene scanner. It, scans your genes, puts your genetic signature into a database, and allows you through all corresponding gates.
Because again, it's the future. Alright, what we have to do is we're gonna go ahead and get a weekly pass.
I'll get a weekly pass, just in case.
Now we need to give it our cash card.
$15 subtracted from cash card. You are now free to travel on all Metroline subways for exactly 1 week. And remember, genetic forgery is a federal crime. Keep your genes clean. Have a nice day.
Genetic forgery? Okay, whatever. Don't need that anymore. Okay, we can go get on the train now. This guy's just standing here trying to decide if he wants to get on this train or not, I guess. Oh, guess he decided against it. Okay, on the train, the way we get on off, and yeah, it looks like every train we have today, too, doesn't it? Is that a stapler up there? What if it's a red swing line? Whatever. Okay, we're going to the West Watertown Bridge, which is where the gallery is.
Poor guy's drugged out on amethyst. They say the first motor function to suffer is always rhythm.
Okay, now this is actually the gallery they're standing in front of.
Another victim of amethyst.
It's a little hard to tell. And, is that a yellow sign right there? Have you seen the yellow sign? Okay, let's go into the gallery, which is a little hard to see. It's right here.
Hello, sir. Sir? I'll just leave my ticket here then, shall I? Yes. Yes, I guess I'll do that.
Alright. Now we can move around the gallery and look at these things. And, oh, here's Cortez.
For the life of me, I can't figure out why Cortez wants to meet me. Come to think of it. I want to meet him.
That's the question we're all trying to figure out, April, but hey, we're just the player here.
About time you showed up.
About time? I spent more
Mira,
than...
this painting. Right here. Look.
Mira?
You brought me all the way down here to look at a painting?
Yes. But there's more. Just look at it.
Who's the artist?
A boy named Warren Hughes. Not so long ago, I knew him and his family quite well. But he does not paint anymore.
It's nice work.
It's very nice. But there's more to it than nice. Keep looking.
Yeah, what am I looking for?
What do you see?
Yeah, there's no way to do this except to go through the entire tree.
I see a guy hugging a girl.
And?
They're probably boyfriend-girlfriend, and she's dumping him. He looks really depressed.
Yes, yes. Forget the story. What do you see?
I see an oil painting of two humans locked in an embrace.
That's all you see? But there's so much more. Look. Look.
I see a statement on loss. The guy, he's hugging a girl. And by all rights, he should be happy, but he's not. He's probably already mourning the loss of her, even though that's still somewhere in his future.
Statements? Who cares about statements? Tell me what you see.
I see art.
Art, yes. And beyond that, beyond art.
Yeah, you have to go through the whole thing. I mean, it won't let you shortcut.
Truth?
Truth. Exactly. A deeper truth. This painting, this particular work of art, speaks a deeper truth. It has a soul.
How can a painting have a soul?
It has a soul because it has an identity. It has a heart. The memory of this painting will survive beyond this moment. It will linger in your mind, become part of the tapestry of your subconscious. It has made a lasting impression on you. And you're not quite sure why.
It's just a painting by some kid. It's not as if it's a Picasso or a Monet.
Now you're arguing technique. Not every painting by Van Gogh or Michelangelo is real art either, although they all demonstrate great technique and craftsmanship. And the scribbled drawings of a 5-year-old child are rarely technically impressive, but they may still have a soul. They may still be real art.
So you're saying real art is not defined by the skill of the artist? Then what is art? If just anybody can create something more real than artists who've spent their entire lives developing their skills?
Art is still the work of artists. And skill, craftsmanship, technique, those things are critical to the success of an artist's work. But alone, those things are merely pretense. For something to be real, to be truthful, the artist must transfer, shift part of him or herself into the work to transcend the illusion and reach for the truth of art.
And what is the truth of art?
Who knows? I've been asking myself that question for years.
Excuse me? You don't even know? And what's all this about all the questions and lectures on truth and illusion? For that matter, why did you ask me to come down here in the first place?
Because...
Actually, you didn't even ask me to come down. I spent my entire afternoon traveling all over Venice, deciphering a cryptic message, spending money I don't have on a subway ticket, only to have to stand here and listen to...
You saw something this afternoon. A waking dream, and you can't explain it. That's why you are here, isn't it?
How the hell do you know these things?
It's as plain as the day, Señorita Ryan. You're under a lot of stress. My point about art and truth is this, April. Some things look real, but are not. And other things may appear to be of no consequence at all, but are in fact invaluable. Like Warren's painting here. And your dreams. There is both truth and illusion in dreams, and in the images they create. The problem is in sorting the one from the other.
You're telling me my dreams are true?
I'm telling you there are things afoot, and that you need help in sorting the truth from the illusions. My help.
Well, that figures.
Good. I was hoping you'd understand.
No. Actually, I didn't understand a single word. You talk about art, and truth, and dreams, and illusions, and I still don't understand what it all has to do with me. There are things happening, yes, and I came here because I thought maybe you're crazy enough to believe me, to help me. I don't know, sort through the debris and come up with the plausible explanation. But no, you tell me my dreams might be true, that I need your help, and that there are things afoot. I mean, who says afoot? I've never heard anybody use the word before. There are things afoot.
Está bien. I understand your reluctance to believe me, señorita. But I cannot convince you here, now. Meet me tomorrow.
What?
Meet me tomorrow. And I will tell you everything.
Not again, no way.
But you will. because you are compelled to do so by your own curiosity, because you are drawn to mystery, and because despite your skepticism, you believe I have the answer to all your questions, yes?
No. No, I don't care. I just want to have a normal life. No nightmares, no visions, no strangers telling me that things are afoot. Comprende, amigo?
Ay, Dios mío. Is that the time? I've got to run, Señorita Ryan. I'll see you tomorrow, then.
I said...
Goodbye.
She's Orion. Just say, would you kindly come see me tomorrow, when she will. She won't understand why, but... I think that goes with being Orion. Anyway, come to think of it, Zack was trying to get her to pop some raptures with her earlier, too. A Ryan having something to do with raptures. Now, where have we heard that before? This game came a few years earlier.
It's a short, nude creature with a snout. Very inspiring.
All right. And she has never heard anybody say anything is afoot. So, we're expected to believe that Star Wars and Nancy Drew have survived, but no one in the 23rd century knows who Sherlock Holmes is. I'm disappointed. This guy has a boombox down here. We don't have boomboxes in 2014. Okay, we're heading back. Newspaper! They're still reading newspapers in the 23rd century. Oh god, I could need to quit making fun of the bad future predictions, don't I? Okay, let's head back to the... Well, the skater boys are gone. Now, I didn't talk too much about when we talked to Emma earlier. There was one piece of conversation I skipped over. She talked about Cortez a bit. Apparently, Cortez is around 60. And Emma is fascinated by Cortez for some reason. She thinks he's a very interesting man. Of course, we know about Emma's taste in men, so I did miss that one little bit of data. But let's get over here and go to work.
I'm all scrubbed and ready to work, sir.
You'll be on the floor tonight, honey. Start taking orders.
I'm trying to decide if the things on his outfit are supposed to be Chinese characters or circuits. I don't know. Well, it looks like Emma's gone finally. That big guy's been sitting at the bar the whole time. And then something weird happens, and we're going to go into chapter 2 here, so I'm going to fade out after this. Until next time, when we come back to The Longest Journey. I will see you later.